Yes, the build-up to the Euros final on Monday morning between England and Italy continues here on the Shooting Tsars podcast with me, Stuart Marshall. Once again, I'm without my main men, Bryce and Alex, but in their absence, I bring you something a little bit different this time around. Joining me now is a man who took 3 years to reply to my Instagram message to come on the pod. He rose to fame on the Triple J Breakfast Show as the Liam part of the duo Ben and Liam. He's now hosting Nova 919 Brekkie with Ben in his hometown of Adelaide. His name is Liam Stapleton. Liam, welcome finally to the Shooting Tsars podcast.
Stu, it's good to be here. And, you know, all I can say is I've just got really bad internet at my house. I don't have NBN yet. So the message only just came through, mate. So, right. I mean, yeah, with about a 3-year buffer time at the moment, playing FIFA Ultimate Team, really hard, a lot of lag. So obviously I got back to you as soon as I saw the message. And, you know, this is as quick as I possibly could have got onto the podcast. So that's that covered. And now we can get into it.
Yeah, right. Okay. Well, you've kind of explained the delay, but my first question was going to be,
yeah,
why did you tease me 3 years ago and say that you would come on the podcast? For those that are listening, we had a bit of dialogue. You said you'd come on, and then when I tried to organize a time, you just completely blanked me. Why did you do that? But you say it's because of your internet.
To be honest, I have no idea. I mean, to be honest, I saw it and I was like, shooting's up, okay, podcast, and I like clicked on it. And I'd actually forgotten about the messages in the first part. To be honest, what I do is I sort of like, I never really touch my requested folder. And then every now and then I'm feeling generous and I like sort of go through and sort of will just like knock out podcasts or like if people want birthday messages or whatever it is. And I had I've been in quarantine at the moment. Went on holiday to Queensland and SA closed the borders. Got back and I've been doing things that I don't normally do, like read books. And I thought, oh, you know, I'm going to get work through my messages a little bit. And I saw this one and I was like, oh, damn. And now I felt bad because, never came on the podcast the first time. But here we are now. And thank you for having me on. I mean, it's exciting being able to talk about the world game. I'm certainly not talking about it a hell of a lot in the mornings doing the show because obviously we know we're living in a bit of a football country, especially Adelaide, South Australia, big sort of footy town. So I sort of have to keep my chat to a little bit of a minimum, but I still squeeze it in there. I got a Liverpool tattoo on the show last year when they won the Premier League. That was exciting.
I'm keen to ask a little bit about that in a couple of minutes' time. But before we move on to my first real question, you're saying that you feel generous and you look through the DMs. You're actually the most famous guest on this podcast, I believe, 59,000 Instagram followers. So what, how many are you getting a day? Like, give a bit of insight to those that aren't on the same level. How many sort of, you know, random messages are you getting each day? You know what I mean? Like, are you like, okay, I'll have a look now?
Sort of depends. It sounds like a flex, but it's always in the 99 plus in requested. That's so cool. And I'm just going through now, 4 hours ago, 10 hours ago, 19 hours ago, 19 hours ago, 23 hours ago, one day ago, one day ago, one day ago.
What are the messages? A lot of people like? Are they just random fan messages?
Like this guy yesterday, it's coming home with some sort of flags there. So that's, it's good to see. Some people sort of know I support a little bit and then they sort of get into me. For example, there's this lovely fellow here who's just written gay shit, bro, replying to my story. Cool. So he's not going to get a response. I can see the message before that was on my birthday. He said, "Oi, staple dick," and sent me some KFC shoes. Also, like, it's a bit of a theme on the show that I'm like a bit obsessive over KFC. So every time like a chain like meme comes out about KFC, I get like everyone sends it to me. Do you know what I mean? Like, you know, and some people, like, if there's like a meme that your friends would think you'd like, and then they send it to you, and I sort of get a lot of that. So most of it's just KFC memes and people calling me staple dick or, you know, whatever. But I mean, yesterday there was a few people getting up me. You can't win, like, sort of like getting up me there, like, oh, watch a real sport. And then, people getting up me for supporting England, which, I mean, to be honest, as far as the Euros go, that's my team. My parents are from the UK. So
cool.
I think everyone has that sort of second nation. Obviously, the Socceroos are my first and foremost when it comes to international football. But, there was a few people that knew, because I have my Irish nana on the radio show sometimes, and there's a lot of angry Irish people that I would, their support. But, that's the grandparents. That's another level up. And also, I would be I'd be supporting Ireland as well if they were in it. One of my mates has got, he's got a Scottish mum and a English dad, and he's kind of he's a bit torn because it is that, you know, the Scots obviously want to see the Brits get pummeled, which has been super funny seeing all the stuff online of them supporting all the other teams. I don't know if you've been keeping up with those sort of memes, like how they're on the Italy bandwagon now.
Oh well, I've actually got a Scottish mum and an English dad as well, so my family's torn as well.
where are you going? Like, I'm interested. Where are you sort of thinking?
Well, mum will just follow us, but we're England fans. So my dad's from Newcastle in England. So England through and through, and especially given what's going on. So yeah.
Yeah. Well, this is where I stand. I'm kind of like, I really want to see England win it, but if I'm honest, in the group stages, I thought it would have been like funny to see Scotland beat England. Like I would have liked to have seen that. Do you know what I mean? Just so they had their, like, I support, but not to that extent. Like obviously Australia, I'd want Australia to win all the time, but yeah, I wouldn't mind seeing like the Brits lose to the Scots. It's just because they'd never like let it down. Like, right. I mean, you know, the Socceroos beat England like 3-1. I think that was Wayne Rooney's like first international cap. Yeah. And he still looks like he's like a 40-year-old man, even when he was like 17. But I've got the DVD of that game, actually. The Scots would just, they'd never live that down, which is cool.
Yeah. All right. Well, you've given us a bit of insight into your knowledge, which kind of is a good preface to my initial question. So what I was thinking of doing was, given, you know, you're not known for your football now, so at least to the majority of the Perth audience, obviously, because you're now working on radio in Adelaide. But I was going to say, obviously, joining a football show isn't maybe something you've done a hell of a lot, I'm going to hazard a guess at saying. So I figured I'd test you to see whether you can kind of walk the walk now that you've joined this podcast.
Yeah, sounds good.
And I was going to ask you one question. So please, Liam, answer me this. Is football coming home?
I think it is. It's coming home. It's coming. Football's coming home. I think the Three Lions will roar. I mean, Italy are going to be hard to topple, but because they've gone like 30 plus straight or whatever it is now. But I think it'll make it all the more sweeter. But to be honest, the scene's set, like, it's essentially a home ground. We're talking Wembley Stadium, packed full of fans. If they don't, it might never come home. Like, this is, you couldn't like write the script. You know what I mean? Like, it's kind of like, it is just perfect. So hopefully they can just squeeze it out. I mean, it was interesting seeing, the Denmark game, obviously going a goal down for the first time in the tournament, sort of like, you know, you can see them a bit shaken there. That was also a tricky one. Watching the game, because obviously I wanted to see England win, but then also obviously all the stuff that happened with Ericsson, I think everyone was loving the Denmark underdog story. And I mean, when you look at it, I think they outplayed them, especially near the end of the game. But an own goal and a sort of sloppy penalty is kind of like not the nicest way to go through, especially when that free kick, that absolute world class free kick, went into sort of give Denmark the dapper hand to start with. So I was a bit torn on that. I love Kasper Schmeichel as well. I think he's like absolutely elite keeper. I like him more than Pickford as well. So, and I mean, his game at, I don't know if you watched the FA Cup final this year against Chelsea.
Saw that.
But, oh man, he's hero. He made like two or three saves, which is just absolute top shelf. Like, so I was kind of rooting for him as well, but I am glad England won in the end. I wish they just did it in a nicer fashion, to be honest.
Yeah, I agree with you. I mean, that penalty, let's talk about that penalty then. Did you think it was a penalty? Sterling, did he go down too easy?
Yeah, it went down way too easy. I think, to be honest, I think the challenge on Kane, I think it was like 20 minutes prior, was a penalty, but there was a foul just before that. There was, like, if you watch that one back, you're like, that's a penalty. But yeah, I think there was a English foul just sort of like, couple of seconds before, so that's when they were going to VAR, I was like, oh my god, it's a penalty, but they probably deserved a penalty for that alone. And also the Sterling, you know, the own goal, Sterling like probably should have slotted that like exact same chance like a minute prior when Schmeichel came out and made that insane save.
Oh yeah, so, knocked it right at him.
Literally. So that, it kind of seemed like a carbon copy of that, like it was the cross in and so, I don't know, that's just the way it works sometimes. But, I mean, you know, in a year's time, who's going to remember how they did it, if they end up doing it? Exactly. I'm hoping for an exciting final, though. But to be honest, I also seeing how far Spain pushed out Italy, it kind of gives me a little bit more hope. I thought they would just absolutely cream Spain, but they took them out of penalties, obviously. So I think there is a chance that it could be coming home.
Yeah, it will be fascinating to see how the final plays out. How have you seen England's tournament? Obviously, it's been a lot of little storylines there. You mentioned at the start that maybe you were hoping Scotland would get the wood over England in that game just for the hilarity factor. But how have you been watching every game? You said you're on holiday before we started.
Consuming everything. Yeah, absolutely, man. Every single England game so far. Even like that Scotland game was the most boring game of the lot. Actually, to be honest, the first game was probably the most boring until that. I mean, I know Sterling scored and sort of broke the deadlock, but it was once again like kind of a sort of scrappy goal. So I wouldn't say they've been the most entertaining team to watch. Even though they are the team I'm rooting for, and I love like watching the fans like absolutely lose it as well. And I sort of understand the gravity sort of behind it. Well, I think every football fan does. And so that that's been really. I mean, to be honest, Italy have probably been more exciting to watch just purely from the sort of the goals and the suits and the the razzmatazz behind them all. I can't say I'm the biggest Italy fan after what happened in 2006. I think none of us will ever forget that.
No.
To be honest, they're probably one of my least favorite national teams after that because I just hold a grudge. I've been watching games here and there, and I sort of make sure I watch the highlights if I've got a bit of time up my sleeve. I watch the whatever it is on Opta Sport, like the 25-minuter.
And then
if I don't have time, I'll just crunch out those little 3 minutes. Sometimes you just squeeze them in when you're on the toilet, watch them on your phone, whatever. but it's been an awesome tournament. Hey?
Yeah.
Like it's probably been one of my favorite tournaments. I reckon the last time I enjoyed the tournament this much was maybe Euro 2008, the one at Spain won.
Sure.
It was just like prime Spain, like we're talking Davavia. And
the beginning of the dynasty Torres. As well, right? They went Euros, like World Cup, Euros consecutively. Mm-hmm. So,
and it was sick. Casillas was my favorite keeper as well, and just the whole team was like so well rounded. They beat Italy on penalties actually in the semi final, which was
how good.
Which is a ripper. I actually had that Casillas sort of like on his knees, sort of like I had like a frame in my bedroom, like of that. Of that sort of moment.
Oh, so you wake up every day and just celebrate a little bit.
Yeah, with Ike. I don't know. It's just been cool seeing some underdogs like Switzerland. I'm a Liverpool fan, so it's been cool seeing Big Shaq do his thing and, obviously knock France out. And Patrick Schick, just like an absolute
dominate.
King. Like, dude. But the Czech Republic have been fun. So, I feel like it's, the Denmark thing. There was a lot of like... teams that were knocking out like smaller sort of countries, but knocking out some big sort of heavy hitters, which is cool to see, especially when you're a little bit of a passive sort of supporter in the sense that, I want England to win, but I'm not going to cry if they don't. Like when Australia in a World Cup, it's just, you're sort of like biting your nails and everything. You're just sort of like, to be honest, it'll be a dream come true if we get out of the round of 16 one day. Like, you're probably not really realistically going to win it in the next 100 years. But those games, I'm always like, I get really nervous before them. And just, you want it just the journey to go on a little bit longer, especially because you got to wait so much longer until the next one. And same with like Champions League football with Liverpool, that get really nervous over that.
Okay. So you mentioned Liverpool a couple of times there. And I think you said your dad's English. Is that right? So how did you come to love the beautiful game? What's your in to the sport?
Yeah, I suppose dad, really. I'd sort of been playing it since I was four. I hung up the boots when I was 18, chronic chafing, could have gone pro. Dad's always sort of big on it. He's from Coventry, so pretty hard to support them. So I sort of, I think there comes a point when you sort of choose your own team in Australia, sort of, especially like, realistically, I liked sort of watching the Champions League games on SBS. We didn't have Foxtel growing up. So it was always going to be a Liverpool, a Chelsea, a Manchester United.
Sure.
For me, Liverpool was the one I started supporting. My dad, he supports Liverpool now too. It's also a little bit easier to get around the games.
So there's no family connection to Liverpool. You're just like every other Australian fan that just picked the best team.
Just picked one, pretty much. Yeah. And I also...
Sad.
Beatles fan, so I suppose that's sort of where that came from. But I can't say it would bring me much joy barracking for Coventry, I must admit.
Where are they now? Do you keep tabs on commentary? They're what, in the championship nowadays, or what?
Yeah, I think they are in.
League One, maybe.
I think that League One. I was about to call it Coca Cola One. Remember on back in the day, I think it was Coca Cola when you were like picking teams like Coca Cola One, Coca-Cola, 2, and 3. So I think they're not in the championship. They're the league below that, and they were like halfway through last time I checked. But
so did you? Because Coventry were in the Premier League in the early noughties. So I assume your dad would have been right into it then.
Yeah, well, they won the FA Cup '80s or something like that. Yeah, so and they've had some like cool players play for them over the years, but purely it's just kind of hard to like, you know, especially pre-internet being a thing. Like when you're you know what I mean. Like it's just tricky to watch those games.
Well, yeah, so. I remember, like you say, SBS had the rights, but I remember the way that I like really got into it. My earliest memories of watching at least English soccer with my Geordie father was do you remember SBS or like the Premier League productions would put out an hour highlight show? I don't know if you ever remember that.
Yeah,
but that was kind of like how me and my dad used to sit down religiously and my brother every Wednesday night or whenever Monday night, whenever it was on. And that was like the only way we could see the game. So it's like, you know, now we can watch every game. So yeah, it's come a long way.
Obviously a Newcastle man, like around that, like the Alan Shearer, end of the Alan Shearer sort of days. Is that when you were on board?
Yeah, that was, you know, all that team. Nobby Solano, I don't know if you remember him. Lauren Robert, and there was like Sir Bobby Robson was the manager, and then Graeme Souness came in. So that sort of era. I was probably too young to really remember Les Ferdinand and Alan Shearer and, you know, the Newcastle Brownow top of like that team, the entertainers under Brownow's, Kevin Keegan and all that. So,
that's when they were like sort of dominating. But didn't.
Yeah.
Am I wrong in saying Shearer only won with Blackburn Rovers? Did he win one with Newcastle?
No. You're spot on. He won in 95, 96 with Kenny Dalglish, the Blackburn manager. And then.
Yeah, right. Because it seems like he would just, you know, would have naturally done it with Newcastle because they were such a successful team. The last sort of great Newcastle era from my perspective. Like, you're like, shut up. No, you shut up.
No.
But like, I reckon like around like 2007, 2008, like.
Michael Owen.
Shearer was on his last. Yeah. And like, didn't like Denbar Barr and that sort of stuff.
He was like a couple of years later. Yeah.
Cool team to support. Yeah. He was a couple of years later. Right. Yeah. But I mean, I like some Maxim now and, Jonjo Shelby. Yeah. He's cool, man. You've got a few like entertaining players. And I also like those like classic sort of. I mean, I obviously don't want him to beat Liverpool ever, but I like those classic sort of honest. Working class British sides that have a lot of history, and like Newcastle's definitely one of those. Yeah, and Sunderland till I die, soul destroying, but I also enjoyed that.
Yeah, that's a good one. That's a Netflix doco for those that maybe haven't seen it. But it's been fascinating, the Newcastle team and sort of the evolution of the team. Now we're just kind of holding on to Premier League status every year. So we managed to hold on, but maybe let's talk a little bit about Liverpool.
Yeah.
And maybe we can touch on this tattoo that you got in your arm. So for those that maybe follow you or don't follow you, I remember seeing this when you got it done. What was it you got when Liverpool and Man City were battling it out for the Premier League title? What?
Yeah.
Not last season, the season Liverpool lost it by a point to City. That's when the City went set two in a row. And you preempted it. Were you still working at Triple J at that point? And you got
And
you got the Liverpool champions 1920. So for those that maybe haven't seen it, look on the Instagram. But can you look on your Instagram? But can you just talk us through this whole arm tattoo that you got now? Because you've recently amended things.
Updated last year. So I got Liverpool FC champions 19. Actually, it was 19, and it was actually before the Barcelona game. So I kind of thought it would be. I kind of always thought, I was like, look, I hope it suits, but I always had the idea of like, I would update it someday once we eventually did win one. But it was kind of flawed because I called it for the Premier League. I'm like, you know, we're going to get it done. I thought Brighton, you know, might have beaten City, big shock. And they were 1-0 up for like 30 seconds. So I got Liverpool FC Champions 19. And we didn't win the league, obviously, even though getting that record amount of points, it was just the most wild season, wasn't it? I think it was like, we had 97 points and City had 98.
I think it was 1 point in it.
It was insane. And but then obviously we ended up sort of just before the end of the season, we had that crazy comeback, Barcelona 4-0, and then won the Champions League. So it's kind of not really like we did win a cup in 2019, actually. So it's not like completely wrong, but because it was intended for the Premier League last year when we finally ended up doing it in June, Ben, who I host the show with, he freehanded it and fixed it. Well, I mean, I say fixed it, probably made it worse, but with a slash 20 and then season written underneath freehand. So it is like, sometimes I forget about it, but I went, was doing some diving in the Great Barrier Reef over the holidays, while I was in Queensland, had to do the quarantine stuff. And some guy was like, is that Liverpool tattoo like real? And I was like, oh yeah, like, yeah, I mean, obviously it's real. I don't know. It's not like a Freddy Frog tattoo. But then I have to like explain the story. But then I'm also like, people get all sorts of like, tattoos of like wolves and, pine trees and shit like that. So I'm like, I'm happy to explain the joke, and I love Liverpool. So it's meaningful to me in that sense. But I might have to, fix it up someday. I don't think I'm going to get a full sleeve anytime soon. So I think I'll just live with it.
I was going to say, is there going to be any extensions on it? Or like, do you wake up some days and look at yourself in the mirror and go like, what the fuck did I do?
Yeah, no, it sucks. It does suck. To be honest, like very minimal. Once again, like, fighting an uphill battle sometimes talking about Premier League to the masses in Australia, didn't really get a very good reaction on the show. And I was like, shit, I've like ruined my body and no one really cared about the bit. We've done a lot more things that had more of an impact, but it's meaningful to me because I love Liverpool. I'll show you something quickly. I'm just in my spare room here. This obviously doesn't work. Do you actually upload this video anywhere?
Yeah, this is going on YouTube. So for those that are maybe listening on podcasts and want to see what's going on, jump over to the YouTube page and watch this. Watch the episode.
Got this little drawer here. Okay. This is my little Liverpool drawer. I've got the Champions League Carlsberg beers. That actually tastes very good.
Right.
Down here, I've got the Liverpool Sanders, haven't worn them in years, but look at the kits here. Got like, this is one of my favorites,
Torres kit. Yeah,
the Torres, when it was like prime Torres
when he first came to the club,
literally. Yeah. And I got the long sleeve as well, which he always used to don with those lovely locks. I've got the Pepe Reina.
Okay, were you a keeper when you were young? Is that
I was. You're looking at South Australia's state under 15 goalkeeper right here, mate. Show some respect.
Really?
Yeah, man. Got a Gerard here.
Okay. Got there we go.
A whole stack of kits. So, and then like this is an old dog leash one.
Yeah.
It's like a classic knockoff. But I got some sort of little drawer there of all the old Liverpool kits. So yeah, it's all right. I keep those. I also like look terrible in them because I've got a little bit of a beer belly. When I say a little bit, I mean a massive beer belly. So I don't know if you find that, but you have to be very athletic to look good in a shirt mainly worn by athletes.
Yeah. Just wear a t-shirt under it or something like that. A long sleeve shirt with a kit over the top generally looks all right. So
yeah, true.
You can hide things. Well, right, so you mentioned that you were legitimately the state 15's goalkeeper for South Australia. Can you just maybe explain this a little bit more?
Yeah.
Firstly, a couple of questions that are springing to mind. Why were you a keeper? And two, why did you stop playing?
So this is the thing. People are like, why are you working on the radio? That's great. This is trash for me. I wanted to be the goalkeeper for Liverpool.
And my dreams
never came true. I did. Just like a lot of, Aussie kids, that was the dream. When anyone asked me what I wanted to do, I wanted to play for Liverpool. So when I was 10, I realized I was atrocious at actually playing on the outfield, as you know how it starts a lot of the time with the keepers.
Smart.
And around that time it was my 10th birthday was the actual day that Australia beat Japan 3-1 in the first game of the 2006 World Cup.
Okay.
So I turned 10 on that day, and so I was already inspired when I was sort of 9 from the heroics of Mark Schwarzer in the Uruguay qualifier and the penalty shootout.
Yeah.
And so Schwarzer was like my hero around that time. That sort of really got me into goalkeeping. So, I played for a few teams over the years. And I played for Mumbai Jets, Campbelltown, Blue Eagles. Probably means nothing for anyone in
Shout out to those suburbs.
Shout out to the SA listeners.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then I was properly right into it till I was about 17, 18. Loved it. Like went to the UK on one of those sort of tours with some goalkeepers from around the country, and we got to train at Liverpool, which was cool, and Chelsea and a few of the bigger teams. We got to train with Schwarzer at Fulham over a few days.
So, wow, okay.
that was killer. And to be honest, I just sort of fell out of love with it. Like when I was sort of 17, like late 16, 17, I just sort of like, I mean, from like 13, I was like one of those kids that's just sort of training every single day. So, and I loved it. I was obsessed with it. And then, just kind of like realized, I don't really want to do this anymore. Like I'd started doing, from when I was 15, I was doing community radio as well. So that was kind of like a side thing I was doing, which is kind of like, what a weird kid. I'm like doing all this goalkeeper training and doing community radio. And then, I was obsessed with it, but like keeping never sort of came naturally to me. Like I enjoyed it. But I was, sort of working really hard for it. And then the radio stuff I was really enjoying, but it's sort of coming to me a bit more naturally. And I sort of, got to a point where sort of just made the call to give it away and sort of pursue the radio thing and sort of, led to a career. So that's cool. And I mean, who knows, maybe if I stuck with it, it would have led to a career. Some of the people I played with are sort of A-League now, and a lot of people just quit. Like
everyone gets sick of it, don't they?
Yeah, well, that's it. It's still like a tricky life. Like one of my good mates is Jordan O'Doherty, who's A-League player. He's just moved to Newcastle Jets from Western Sydney Wanderers, started off at Adelaide United, did a stint at Melbourne Victory as well. And like, it's a tricky life for those guys. Like he had a big ACL injury last year, which was shocking. Like, that's like, I couldn't think that if I had some sort of, injury in my throat or something. I could pretty much work through anything. I do radio, but like not being able to do what you love for a whole year, like would be so tricky. So, and then sometimes, you sort of get moved around and you've got to resettle in a new place. And it's not an easy life being a professional footballer. So I definitely admire those guys and all the and girls and all the sacrifices they make to get to that point, and then how hard you have to work at stay your there all the time to stay there. Yeah, it's crazy. It's So I don't know. I think I'm happy with the call I made, and I'm not sort of saying for one second that I would have ever ended up playing professionally. But it's you really got to love it like wholeheartedly to have a proper crack at it, don't you?
And I think I agree with what you're saying. And Alex Grant, who's one of the three that are on this podcast, I do these interviews on the side as well, but our usual show, Alex is our current player and he's playing at Pohang Steelers, but he would probably understand everything you're saying as well. Moved over to England, played on Portsmouth's books, was on Stoke City's books, came back to Perth and sort of really cut his teeth at Perth Glory and is now over in Korea with his young family. So he's plenty of stories about that and having to move around, but now he's obviously traveling through Asia and has been playing in the Asian Champions League and sort of going through Thailand and crazy life, isn't it? Well,
and it's like all of a sudden, like there's I'm also mates with a fella named Ryan Strain who just finished up playing at Adelaide United. It's moved over to Israel of all places. Like you're seeing a lot of these A-League players now like having a crack in all these sorts of different countries, probably getting paid a hell of a lot more as well. So good on them. But like, that's such a move to just move your whole life to, it's completely different cultures and creeds and different religions and things. And it'd be a bit of culture shock, I'd imagine, when you first move over. But I suppose that's, when you think about it, the dream is to play for one of these big Premier League clubs, but also like getting paid a good wage while you can. While you're young, doesn't matter where you're playing, like if you're getting paid to actually play for a team. But it was also crazy, like I was kind of like, he was out for dinner with some of the players and I was looking at his Instagram story, and like one of the dudes who's on this team was obviously sort of not a name that I recognize from Real Madrid, but he would have started a few games. And like I was kind of like looking at his Instagram, there's like photos of him like playing with Ronaldo, like CR7 Ronaldo. It's crazy, isn't it? Like some people can make it as well, but you might have never heard of them, sort of thing.
Wait, so do you go to many A-League games? You said obviously you got a couple of friends and you played state level, but do you follow the Adelaide United closely?
I certainly should more. I've been to a couple of games since I've been back in Adelaide. I lived in Sydney for 3 years and only went to the Australia games and when Liverpool came at that time, but I didn't really get around. I literally lived next to Allianz Arena and I never went to the Sydney FC games. I went to a couple when Adelaide came, but I was a member for like 10 years and like had the same seats. Used to go with my dad to every game and froth that. So my knowledge of like Adelaide United, like 2006, 2007, like
Travis Dodd. Good.
Yeah, Travis Dodd.
You know what? Van Dijk, was that his name, the striker?
Yeah, Van Dijk. Yeah, he was like a little bit later on, but he was elite. But yeah, Ange Costanza, I don't know if you remember him. There's some Nathan Burns. He played in China. I think he ended up moving to China, but like, he was one of my favorite players.
He played in Romario. I actually saw Nathan Burns, me and Alex Grant. We went on a trip to Japan in 2016 and Nathan Burns was playing for FC Tokyo and we went and watched him play in Tokyo. So yeah, he went to Japan, not China, but yeah, no.
We had Robbie Corn played as well.
Thing in Adelaide now, Robbie Corn played.
He is. The other day, you reminded me saying that there, like, have you seen that meme before of Ben Affleck just like sucking a durry, like, and he's like, just like staring and he's like taking staring five. Into the abyss. And people post it on Christmas and stuff, being like at lunch, like after speaking to my family. The other day I walked past the Wellington pub in North Adelaide and there was a guy like sucking a durry, like looking into the abyss, like next to the pub. And it was Travis Dodd. And he reminded me exactly of that meme. And I sort of like was like looking at him and then he like saw me looking at him and I just sort of gave him a nod like Travis Dodd. And he sort of gave me a nod back and that was it. Just a little bit of acknowledgement. And just kept walking along. But yeah, it's crazy. Like a lot of those guys now obviously just, you know, have sort of jobs and day-to-day life. But I mean, you know, a lot of them sort of did at the start of the A-League. I went to the inaugural Adelaide United game against Newcastle Jets. Carl Beard scored a goal. First goal in A-League history. I was there.
Wow.
And Carl Beard's the coach now of Adelaide United.
Yep.
But yeah, I mean, most of them are just like real estate agents and playing, you know, on the weekend. So it's cool. Like at least the A-League's come a long way as well.
Mm. Yeah, for sure. Wow. So I think we've definitely uncovered that you are a rusted on football fan. There's no denying it. You've mentioned a couple of times your radio career and I've got a couple of questions for you. Mm. Firstly, have you planned anything for Monday? Should England... So yeah, you back at work on Monday, is it?
I'm back up, yeah. So I start work at 5 a.m. and Adelaide, the game starts at 4:30. So a real pain in the ass.
Okay.
This is also why it's very hard for me to watch a lot of these games.
Have you got anything planned for the show or is there any sort of discussions with Ben potentially about what you may do should England bring it home?
I think Ben is actually going to tattoo 3 lines on my chest.
Like that is an actual thing?
No. No, I learned enough. I learned enough from the last time.
I should have picked that up.
Nah, I to be honest, haven't yet. Once again, it's kind of like, to be completely honest, like as much as I love it, you sort of really need to my job sort of thinking who you're talking to. And for me, it's mainly school mums from Adelaide now is my go-to. So a lot of them don't give a shit. If anything, it's more like, oh, the Poms, like, it's going, you know what I mean? Like, they, how dare you for not supporting Australia? But Australia aren't in the Euros, you see. No, they don't care. So, you know, I'm sure I'll celebrate a bit, but I don't think I'm not going to get a lot of time to be like,
okay. Oh, well, I've got a suggestion for you, all right? So, I don't know whether you've seen this is only dropped in the past 3 days. I actually was showed this last night by my brother. And I was quite amazed by the fact that this had happened. But essentially, you've been keeping up with, obviously, the It's Coming Home jokes. And, you know, I don't know if you've heard the Southgate, you're the one chant. And all. Have you been keeping across this at all?
Yeah.
So essentially, Atomic Kitten, who created that song that the Southgate, you're the one, that song.
Yes.
They created the original, Hole Again. It's called Hole Again. Yeah. So Atomic Kitten, the original song, Hole Again, which is what that tune is two. They have re-recorded their song Hole Again with the lyrics Southgate, you're the one, and football's coming home in it. So what I figured I would do is play maybe a minute or so for you now so you can hear the main lyrics. And then here's an idea. You could potentially play this on your radio show on Monday should England, because one, it's a family-friendly song. And the mums will like it when they're taking their kids to school. So it ticks out.
Atomic Kitten.
So you can self-indulge slightly. And three, it's hilarious. So this is it. And I hope you haven't heard this before. Because this is it. You're going to kind of hear it through my mic, but we'll give it a crack.
I did. Do you know what? It was in my group chat the other day and I didn't click on it.
Okay. So here we go.
Yeah.
If you see me walking down the street, staring at the sky, dragging my 2 feet. You just passed me by. It still makes me cry. Football's coming home again. And if you see me sitting in the stands, laughing at them, joking, doing what I can, I won't put you down, 'cause I want you around. Football's coming home again.
That is sick.
Well, there you go. So that's the tune.
That is good.
I figured I would just suggest that to you as a potential break for you in your radio show.
Yeah.
And that way you can go
and that is good.
Our team. And, you know, maybe not go over the top because, you know, the mums aren't going to know what that song's about, are they? They're just going to think, oh, this is
They're nice. Just going to be vibing out to it. Yeah. That is very good. That actually works too well. I also love the whole Southgate story as well. Like,
yeah, good story.
You know what I mean? It's like a good link in. He obviously missed the penalty, so England didn't make it in 96. And now it's all these years on. He's got the chance to, 25 years on, he's got the chance to repent for his sins.
Yes, he does. And he's done really well this tournament. And he just carries the team well. And I've sort of spoken on this podcast with guests, and we have as a trio, me, Alex and Bryce, about his story. Mm. But he's a very calm, cool, collected guy, isn't he?
Yeah, which is important for a gaffer. But he's no Klopp, but he's up there. I tell you what as well, obviously, in the Italians, you've got it, you know, people see it in the video as well as your background. Couldn't work out how to do Zoom background myself, but you've got the Italian team in all their suits. But, I mean, Southgate, he's been wearing a waistcoat for years.
Yeah.
You know, a waistcoat, rather. Yeah. It looks good. It looks suave as.
Yes.
I like how there is the option for each manager to, like, either go the tracksuit or, like, the big jacket, like, or the club shop, like, wearing all the merch or the suit, which is great. Joachim Lau goes for the white shirt tucked in with a good booger on the lapel.
Yeah.
That's his. And Hansi Flick taking over.
Yeah, he is
as the coach for Germany.
Yeah, so Joachim Lau's now leaving Germany, and you know, I don't know if you saw him in this tournament. Mm. You seen that the vision of him like putting his fingers down his crack and then
scratching
like,
his butthole.
Yeah, and then having a sniff. Yes. But he did it again in this tournament. He did it with the ear or something like that. But he did it with another area. You don't put your fingers in and then immediately bring them to your nose. But he got caught like just watching the game, 60th minute or whatever. Finger in the nose, finger in the ear.
Yeah,
and he was doing the old sniff again. So
a truly disgusting man. I've heard he's giving up national team duties so he can eat his snot and sniff his butt fingers full time. So it's good he's putting some time into the things that he really cares about. And I wish him all the best.
Yes, so do I. So all right. Well, look, I'm glad I could add that piece of maybe solidify that as an idea for your show. And you know, make sure if you do it, you got to give the podcast a shout out, mate. We're trying to grow this show.
Yeah, that's it. That's fair enough.
All right. Let's talk a little bit more about your career because you have mentioned it. You're back in Adelaide now. You started at Triple J, as I said at the start of the show. We'll maybe talk about that transition shortly. But for those that maybe haven't, you know, obviously we got a lot of Perth listeners and now I'm in Sydney. So maybe, who knows, a few in Sydney and maybe a few in Pohang. But you recently spent a week trapped in a glass box in Trundle Mall. Is that correct?
Rundle Mall. So Perth and Sydney, it hurts. Jeez, a lot of people are going to hate that.
Rundle Mall.
Travis Mall. Not included.
Yeah. This is the TR. So there
Trundle
we go.
Mall. Yeah. No, that's fair. It's like a big thing here, but obviously not there.
Yeah, right. Okay. So Rundle Mall in Adelaide City Centre. Maybe. How is that? Because like for those that maybe don't know what it is, go and look on your Instagram and maybe have a little Google. You were literally trapped in a glass box in the middle of Trundle Mall.
Rundle Mall.
Yeah, I know. But Trundle for the sake of this podcast. But how was it? And why did you end up doing that? Because you were raising money for something. Maybe just talk a little bit about it.
Yeah, mate. No, honestly. So we've had just, I'm in my second week off now, but that was, and back to work on Monday, but that was the last sort of week we did on the radio. Honestly, in my almost 10 years now doing radio, that is probably the most sort of meaningful, sort of most important week we've ever done. Like Ben and I were talking about it after he shot off to the airport, like literally a couple of hours after we go to New Zealand for a couple of weeks. But I was like, yeah, I think that's my favorite week in radio so far. So it was trapped because obviously some people can sort of feel trapped in their own mind sometimes when they're experiencing mental health issues. So the whole thing was sort of having positive conversations around mental health and also to raise funds for Lifeline, who obviously speak to people in crisis, 13, 11, 14, if you ever need to call Lifeline. But they're, you know, they're a pretty big national sort of brand. A lot of people know about what Lifeline are about, but in, well, sort of around the country, mostly run by volunteers. I don't know if you knew that, but it's kind of wild, thinking people, yeah, people sort of, you know, work 8 hours and then these like saints are like volunteering their time on the phone, sort of speaking to people in their time of need. So in South Australia, especially, they get no government bunting. Funding. So yeah, we wanted to raise some funds and so sort of people could donate while they're there or whilst they're listening to the show. And yeah, we ended up raising $90,000 for Lifeline. So wow. That was
and,
wild.
And what was the goal?
The goal was 20. So damn, we smashed that. And I was kind of, you know, a little bit disappointed we didn't get to the ton. I wanted to raise the bat, but
yeah.
No, it sort of blew
the nervous 90s.
Exactly. And like, you know, so many people sort of shared their stories with things they've sort of gone through. And yeah, it was a really sort of emotional week, but a great week. And yeah, I mean, to be honest, it was also one of the hardest things I've done. Like I did a marathon last year without any training for a PlayStation 5. And the year before that, Ben and I tandem cycled 180Ks to the One Night Stand, which is a big concert we were doing on Triple J. Mm-hmm. And yeah, this was probably the hardest just because like Rundle was like, I mean, it's just like, obviously that's the main, if you imagine the main shopping strip really in the city. And it was full glass box. We're living in there, no showers, sleeping in there. And people-
Really? 7 days without a shower?
Yeah, yeah. Well, okay. It was five. It was a week, but it was radio week. Monday to Friday. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
And
still tough.
Yeah,
though, man.
Oh yeah, we stunk.
How? Yeah. That's. I'm curious to know just like how long going without it, like that long without a shower, maybe confined in a glass box with another smelly man. What was that like? Oh,
absolutely foul. But you just get used to it, I suppose. But hair was sort of greasy and yuck. Just like felt dirty, especially because we were just. It was hard because like people were, by the end of the week, more and more people were sort of hearing on the radio and coming down to say good day, which is awesome. So there's like lots of families and stuff, but a lot of people were like going to dinner and then coming to see us after.
Mm.
So, you know, it'd be like 10 o'clock at night and we're like writing on whiteboards, like sort of talking to people. And there was also a 24/7 live stream. So it was a little bit like Big Brother, like we've been watching the whole time. And I got Joachim loud a few times and got sprung, like screenshotted, like picking boogers in my nose. Right. And I didn't scratch my butt because no one actually does that. I don't know why he feels the need to do that in the dugouts, but yeah, I got caught out a few times there. But yeah, it was just, you sort of just had to be on the whole time. And you also like obviously wanted to leave everyone with a good impression if they were coming to say good day. So it was hard to, there was one point Ben went to bed one night and sort of like rolled over and then I was like writing a little sign in the window to say, hey, off to bed, you know, see you tomorrow. Thanks for coming. Thanks for supporting us. And saw this little family walking down and I was like, oh damn, okay. And so I like put the sign down, said good day to them, and then like put the sign back up. And then I swear to God, 16 different groups of people came within the space of an hour from like 10 to 11 p.m. So we were so sleep deprived as well because we're up for 4 for the show every morning. So, but you know, it was all in all very worth it and a really, really fun thing.
Yeah.
I was happy with that one.
And a super unique experience that only doing commercial radio like that, you could, you know, like whoever is going to be legally allowed to do that otherwise,
To be honest, it's super weird, but that's also one of the, like a lot of the times, one of the questions I get is sort of like, oh, like, you know, why did you guys leave Triple J? And like, we, especially because, you know, like doing a national show, we just do our show in Adelaide on Nova. We do national sort of weekends. So, if you're in Perth, wherever you are, you can listen on over on Sunday mornings if you're at all interested, or check out, we've got a podcast as well, Ben and Liam. But that's one of the reasons, like after sort of 3 years, we're kind of like, you know, like we sort of loved it, but we thought, hey, time for a new challenge. And we'd sort of done community radio for years before we did Triple J, which is ABC, so public radio. And then we're like, let's give commercial radio a crack. So we're into our second year now, but it's, to be honest, just having a budget as well, like, and a team. Like, we never really had a big team behind us. So now we're like, hey, we want to live in a box for a week. And they're like, cool, well, let's do that. And they can make the box and make it all happen. And then we can, you know, raise all this money. And yeah, it's really cool, like, being able to just bring your sort of crazy ideas to life a lot more. So there's nothing we sort of haven't done yet that we, like, there's nothing we haven't been able to do when we've had the idea as a team. Like, we sort of, everyone finds a way. And yeah, it's really cool.
That's good. Well, that's yeah, that was what I was going to ask. Like, the transition was obviously well publicized as well. How have you found it? Obviously, aside from doing, having more budget, like, do you prefer maybe working more on commercial radio? Do you feel like it maybe fits you better, or do you kind of miss maybe the music side of Triple J?
Oh, look, make no mistake, I prefer Triple J's music. That's for sure. People probably wouldn't mind me me saying that, but yeah, no, music's not for me. But it's also, you know, when, like, I remember seeing comments as well when we moved over, people being like, oh, I heard they listen to Triple J, like, when they throw to a song so they can see. I'm like, come on, man. Like, if you work in radio, you're not listening to the song. Like, you're literally got 3 minutes to be like, shit, what am I going to talk about next? Like, you know what I mean? Like, it's, you're sort of working. So we're not listening to the tunes whilst they're on. But yeah, I think it's probably better suited to us. I probably prefer it a bit just because, purely just because of the, you know, there's just a really great sort of, I loved the team obviously at Triple J as well, but it's just a bit bigger team at Nova, and a lot of really some dedicated people, and they sort of they want to sort of do all these big ideas, and you know, everything has their pros and cons, but yeah, I think we're really happy here. It's also just nice being able to live back in Adelaide. It's kind of like crazy that we can live where we grew up and sort of do our job and still sort of be around our family and friends. Just moving to Sydney, I love living in Sydney, but obviously, like, you know, it's a little bit tricky when you first move over to such a big city. I was 20 when I moved over, and so you sort of got to make a whole new bunch of mates, and sort of I miss the gang there, and I sort of get up to see friends when I can. But yeah, living back here is wild. I mean, we also got to buy a house, which is nice, and you can't do that in Sydney.
Yes, exactly. Right, so bed some roots down, which is good.
That's it, mate. So yeah, loving it. So, and it's, well, I mean, super close to work as well. So everything's close in Adelaide. It's Adelaide. So I can, you know, I'm only probably like a half an hour walk away from Trundle Mall if I want to trundle down there. So there's always good stuff to do here, that's for sure.
Trundle Mall. Lordy. All right. Are you getting sick of these breakfast radio hours? Do you think, like, what's the longevity for a breakfast radio host, do you think?
I don't know. A lot of people
until you get booted off, until the ratings are shit. Is that what it is?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I just signed a big contract, actually. So even if I'm shit, they're going to pay me for a few more years. So
that's good.
It's fine with me. So, yeah, I don't know. I can't see us slowing down anytime soon.
So what time do you get up?
Get up at 4 o'clock every morning.
Yeah. What time are you in bed? At the moment.
I used to be, especially my Triple J days, I used to be a little bit of a party animal, if I'm being completely honest. And there's lots of free gigs and things and sort of cool stuff happening. So I was out, kind of just 11:30 at most, sort of Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, sort of. But obviously a lot later on the weekends. But yeah, now I've mellowed out a little bit more now. So to be honest, I sort of aim for 8:30 if I've got nothing on, just because you just need to, you got to do it to yourself. Especially we work like, the show's, only goes 6 till 9, and you get in at 5 to sort of, plan before, but we're also sort of in until 2, 3 p.m. every day as well, sort of planning and doing videos and that sort of stuff. So there's, you know, even though it's, it is just pissing around for the money, it is, there's a little bit of thought, that goes into it, so... And we're trying to sort of make the best show we possibly can. So especially when you do those bigger things like the box and that sort of obviously takes a lot of planning behind the scenes to make those things happen. So yeah, but I just love it. Like it's hard work, but it's like, it's honestly like the best gig in the world. So
that's good.
I mean, I'm a second to being the goalkeeper for Liverpool, but apart from that, you know, it's right up there. So, Ben and I are going on 8 years doing the show together now. So yeah, it's been quite a while really, but I turned 25, what, last month. So I think that's the other thing, the longevity will hopefully be there a little bit more. I mean, we don't even have kids yet, so we sort of can afford to be getting up early and mucking around and spending weeks away from our partners and that sort of stuff.
So,
we've got a while yet.
Oh, well, that's good. That's a good segue into, I put out a call on Instagram to our many Instagram followers, and we got a few back. So I was pretty happy about that. But
yes, nice.
We will start. Let's start with.
Was it just why'd you leave Triple J? You know, that sort of stuff.
None of that. But going on what you said about you and Ben, having worked together for 8 or so years now. We'll start with the question from Sophie Ferguson. So Sophie said, I know the story, but for maybe those that don't, is how did you get to Triple J?
So I started, as I said, when I was 15, I started at in between under 15s training and all that. I managed to start at a station called PBAFM in Salisbury, which is in the northern suburbs from where I sort of grew up in Adelaide. And it was like the ultimate community radio station, still is, great place. Anyone can sort of rock up and start doing the shows, but it's just like, it's like a Christian sort of rock show, and then the next it's a Congolese drum line, and then after that it's the Cajun cooking and death metal show. Like it's one of those like classic, like every hour is like a different sort of. And then
there's a similar station in Perth, RTRFM 92.1, which is personal. I did a bit of work on that when I was
there you go.
Yeah, when I was in my like early 20s and stuff. So yeah, I know what it's like.
And so like obviously there's all sorts of, so sometimes you tune in and it's like jazz, and other times people speaking like Arabic, doing a show for that sort of community. So it's all over the shop. So I did a show called Jibba Jabba Radio. So I sort of did 92.7, which is another community station in Adelaide, which is probably the biggest one in Adelaide for community radio. It's that, once again, awesome place. So if you're listening and you want to get into radio, it's just community radio is always the answer, to be honest, because you can, one of those crazy things where you can literally have your own radio show, like, you know, whatever level it is, you can sort of go and play some tunes and talk, and there's not many industries where you can do that. So I started at Fresh, and then I met Ben there, and we're doing one show a week, and then we ended up getting a second show, then three shows, then four shows. And then we ended up becoming the first ever people at Fresh to have the first paid gig there, which was kind of like the dream. Like that was all we ever wanted, to sort of get paid for the gig. And we actually brought in a producer with us, even though we didn't know what producers did at that time. And he didn't actually sit in another studio and take calls, because, you know, that would have been, way too silly. So he actually used to sit in there and be really quiet. He used to sit in the studio and be really quiet with us. And then when we threw to a song, we'd all rapidly answer the phones together instead of answering calls, which is like, you know, producers sort of supposed to be doing. So we cut the minimum wage in three ways to bring this producer in, which secretly I reckon that's how we got the gig over other people. And I think we're getting paid like 16 grand a year or something like that. So we did that for 3 years, and then we moved to Triple J, which was the big move. That was sort of, we went from this, you know, little community station to this big sort of national show, and we did that for 3 years. And then, opportunity came up, and they rarely come up, to do a commercial breakfast show in Adelaide, in our hometown. So we thought, hell, this is the next move. So we took that one. And then of course we're gonna sort of like get bigger shows within Nova over the years when people sort of finish up and move on and that sort of thing. So, but I mean, we're quite happy where we are at the moment. We're just but obviously we want to sort of get back to the national scene, hopefully someday with Nova. So it's been it's been quite the journey, but that's just the short version.
Community radio. So we had a few technical difficulties there, but started in community radio, Sophie, and then did what we did, because I actually used to do a radio show with Sophie on community radio, and then got the gig at Triple J. So did you apply for the gig at Triple J? As simple as that?
No, we actually, to be honest, Ben and I, 6 months before we moved to Triple J, we had one week. That's the other thing. We used to have 1 week off a year when we were working at Fresh. So it was hard work. Like, we used to work over Christmas and stuff, and, you know, we put a lot of time into it, but we kind of reached the point where we're like, you know what? I think we've done this now. Like, we kind of, I don't know. I think everyone sort of has that, you know, sometimes in their role, they might be like, yeah, maybe we've sort of outgrown this stage of whatever this is and was sort of ready for the next step. And so we didn't necessarily know what that was, but we used that week to go to Melbourne and Sydney and emailed everyone we sort of knew in radio stations and said, hey, like, Ben Lane from Community Station in Adelaide, we'd love to sort of have 5 minutes of your time. And we set up all these meetings with all these different execs and stuff. And, most of the time, if you email someone and say you're going to, just want 5 minutes of the time, they'll give you an hour, especially if you're flying over for it. So,
yeah.
We met some great people, a lot of people in the industry we still know to this day. And to be honest, Triple J wasn't even on the cast, but when we were there, we knew Tom Ballard, who used to host the show back in the day. So it used to be Tom and Alex, because he came in for interviews on our show at Fresh. And then we ended up getting him, 1 week for the Adelaide Fringe. We got him to, or for the whole month, we got him to come in and just review shows and say what was good to see and that sort of stuff. So we texted him and said, hey, do you know anyone at Triple J? And he gave us the boss's email, Ollie Ward's. He was the boss at the time. And we said, hey, we're in Sydney like today, but from your community radio show, do you mind if we come and say good day? And we did. And he literally did say, to be honest, guys, we will never hire you because you're two straight white guys from Adelaide. So, like, it's probably not what we're really looking for, but which is fair, because obviously, like, diversity is a big thing for the ABC, as it should be. And so we didn't him, really think. Yeah, well, we didn't think. Well, he did pick us, so he obviously went back on that. Yeah. He decided the straight white guys look pretty good for some reason. But we, I think maybe Matt and Alex decided they wanted us to leave within that 6 month period. And he just sort of started asking us for stuff, asked for more stuff. And Ben and I were getting up at 2 a.m. We were coming in to Fresh whilst no one was around, recording a demo for Triple J, sending that, and then starting our actual radio show after that. So, and we were just peppering them with demos as quick as they asked for them. And then they go, oh, why don't you do this one about this? And this one about this? And I remember there was one, they were like, I want to see the other side of you guys. So can you talk about like something harder in your lives, something a bit sadder or whatever. And there was all sorts of different demos. And then, it was kind of out of the blue. Like they sort of said, hey, would you come up to Sydney like the gig? And we kind of knew for couple of months before we announced it, and it's crazy. So that's how it all happens.
That's fascinating. Obviously, I mean, the transition into that role was not easy. I think that's been well documented. No. You've gone public and sort of, you've been really open about the backlash that was faced. Obviously there was comparisons of your voice to Hamish Blake's voice, and there was all sorts of, but there was a lot of hatred pretty much sent towards you guys, and you guys were just trying to do your best, and you copped a lot of online hate. Firstly, is that subsided nowadays? Is there less so?
Yeah,
of that,
man.
Or
that big time.
And
yeah.
So, like, how did you deal with that? Because that's obviously being 20, being thrust into, because in Australian terms, the Triple J Breakfast Show, any show on Triple J, but specifically the Breakfast Show, has been built up as this massive radio show. And you were pretty young getting that gig, so to be in that situation was tough. How did you deal with it at the time, and has it stopped now?
I probably didn't deal with it too well at the time. The first 9 months, it was just brutal, really sort of nasty comments and messages and that sort of stuff. And you always thought it would pass, but it was sort of building up and getting really bad. But then on Are You Okay Day in 2017, I spoke out about sort of my mental health and how it had been affecting me, and really sort of stopped it. It's, to be honest, like, it sort of, I suppose it sort of disarmed. Yeah, I mean, the people that were making the comments maybe had to think twice, and then it sort of made everyone else aware of them and the sort of the effect it had. So that was a pretty eventful day for us, and the sort of outpour of sort of love and sort of admiration sort of came through about the comments rather than the just us as a radio show. But I think people just sort of, when you're sort of vulnerable and honest and raw, sort of on a human level, people sort of relate to that. So
was it hard to, did you have to like wrestle with deciding to go public with it, or was it something you were just like, I have to do
No, there was a lot of shame sort of attached to it. It's hard enough sort of sometimes getting help from family or friends, or someone to speak to professionally. So speaking to
a couple of million big insecurity people at the time, and something that's super brave.
But I was kind of like at my wit's end a little bit, and it was really affecting me. And I thought, like, I'm just gonna get this out there. And that really changed a lot for us. And to be honest, that that's sort of, because that was a big thing, it's been quite well documented. I'm sure if you sort of type the name into Google, you might see it there, to be honest. So it's a question that comes up a lot, but really, like, hasn't been a problem since that sort of point. And our last couple of months of that year and the 2 years after at Triple J were amazing. And, you know, people sort of really started to get around what we were doing. And then this transition to Nova was smooth as, like, if people didn't like it, then I didn't see anything, because A, there's no text line, which, well, there is, but I don't see it anymore. I'm like, I don't actually need to see when people just text in about me, like, straight away. I'm like, that's probably not necessary. Yeah. But I think, to be honest, it's also Triple J, like, super protective. Like, everyone's like, everyone has a sense of ownership over it. Nova's kind of like, you know, like, it's just like Channel 10 or whatever. It's something that's big, everyone knows about it, but maybe less of a sense of ownership. And people were just less psychopathic, basically.
Yeah.
So it was a much
more... it's just because it's all the mums listening, mate. They're nice.
Well, that's it. And also, yeah, so it's just, I think they warmed to us quicker.
Yeah.
And also much thicker skin and sort of confidence in our own abilities now as well. So if you do see those things, you sort of wipe them off a little bit more. But it's happy to say it's been really cruisy for a long time now, which is good, because it makes it a lot easier to do what we do.
What were the what were the Triple J executives? How were they sort of in that time? I'm sure they were supportive, but what was the dynamic when you're going, we're copping, like, obviously it's causing you distress, but like how was it in the office, or like how did the executive sort of approach? Yeah. Was there any sort of mitigation tactics to try and like help in a way before you were going public?
I think there was I definitely felt the love, as in people, everyone felt bad about it, and it was like a very shameful thing. But I wouldn't say there was a lot of things in place.
Yeah.
And to be honest, I said a lot of times, like, can't we just delete these comments or like get rid of this wall post or whatever? There was one wall post in particular that had thousands and thousands and thousands of comments on it that I read. That was one of the things I spoke about that day. I was up all night, read every single comment, didn't sleep, you know, and I was just soul destroying. But yeah, no, it was like, oh well, if we delete it, then people get angry that we sort of... So there was a lot of that. Like, when I look back, I'm not resentful, because sort of Triple J gave us an amazing opportunity, but I definitely don't think there was great things in the workplace sort of available for us at that time. And to be honest, I think it was a bit of a wake-up call, us talking about that publicly. I know there was a lot of training after the fact. A big email went around from the CEO saying, oh, you know, this, like, literally the next day. And there was a lot of, but yeah, I was sort of like, I think also, to be fair, like, times have changing a lot. And, you know, maybe a lot of workplaces hadn't caught up to speed on social media and how it can go sort of skew with, you know what I mean? So there's probably a thing now in workplaces, people need to go, and schools, and people need to go, all right, well, online bullying is a thing. And we need to work out how we can sort of handle that a little bit better. So that's just my mum calling. I'll push on. And just see if, like, the Zoom disappeared on my laptop and it's like,
mom,
came
get
up
out.
Like,
good
answer, mum. I'm out, like, mom. No, I'm in the middle of a really important podcast, mum.
Gosh. Out of my room, mum.
It's a bit of a weird one. I'm being honest, not really. But it was also a hard thing to deal with, and, you know, I don't blame anyone for it. I blame the people who made the comments.
Fair enough. I don't know, when was it, 2017 as well, just before we move on? I guess it's kind of like, even like 24 years ago, it seems like quite a long time considering how far the world's changed. Like, I think it was the Me Too movement that year. So there's been like a lot of social change.
I reckon Me Too was,
I think it was.
Yeah, no, it was probably that year. And then you've also got your Trump stuff. And like, I think a lot of people just got used to being really nasty about other people online. Like, it was a bit of a swell around that sort of stuff. Also, I tell you what didn't help, the fact that we got a lot of this crap on Facebook because we couldn't bring our own Facebook page over the Ben Lamb page that we built at Fresh. We had to get rid of that. And we had to change the name on the Matt and Alex page, the show that was, which was previously Tom and Alex's page. So
fans.
Well, literally, we've got 200,000 all of a sudden of the last show. You know what I mean? Like, if you followed Perth Glory, and then we just changed that to Adelaide United and the profile picture, obviously you know what I mean? That's a recipe for disaster. So, but thankfully the Instagram has been the Benelim Instagram, very safe place, happy place.
That's good.
Been around since 2014, and all those followers only ever followed us. So yeah, that was always a good little place.
Mm, fascinating that you say that, but I guess it all makes sense, and I'm glad it's all changed. All right, this is a different one. This is from my man, Foie Gras Soiree. That's his Instagram name, Felix Silberstein.
Very cool.
He wanted me to ask you this. Not like, so the question is, who the fuck is Liam Stapleton? But not in the sense of like, who is this guy? It's like, who are you?
That's more like it. That's the comments I was expecting. Well, Google me, bro. Hopefully you know by this point. If you've been listening to the podcast and you're waiting for your question to be answered.
Yeah. Yeah, fair enough. All right. John Turner, what's Liam's favourite football memory growing up?
I mean, it's watching Adelaide United beat Uzbekistan 3-0 in the semi-final of the Asian Cup was pretty cool. 2008.
Adelaide United or...?
Oh, it was Adelaide United. Yeah. We weren't supposed to beat Uzbekistan. But, I mean, the best game ever is, it's the Barcelona-Liverpool. I know, like, realistically... The
corner taken one, quickly.
Like, Origi, yeah. Like, realistically, it's probably, it's the AC Milan sort of back 3-0 halftime. But, I mean, I was also a very young Liverpool fan at that point and sort of didn't really understand the gravity of that. But, I mean, without Salah, without Firmino... You're 3-0 down on aggregate against Messi's Barcelona. You've got Suarez, Coutinho, you know, former legends of your team over there. Like, come on, don't talk to me. It doesn't get better than that. Like, no one's saying that. Even if we went 4-0 up and then we conceded a goal, then we still would have lost. So, do you know what I mean? We had to not concede to Barca and score 4, which doesn't happen.
Yep.
And it happened. And Divock Origi scored 2 goals. Yeah, with Messi. Yeah, everyone was there. All the stars were there. Yeah. We were the ones without. We didn't have Salah. Like, we didn't have our main. Do you know what I mean? It's insane. So that game for me was And once again, I was unfortunately at work at the time at Triple J, so I was watching it sort of whilst I was at work. But then I got home and got blind that afternoon, just watching the game in its entirety as God intended.
Yeah, that was an epic. Round in the Champions League. I think the Liverpool game was on the Wednesday, and that was, you know, Tottenham gone, beating Ajax, and there was crazy games. The Tottenham Man City game was in the, you know, a couple of weeks around that, but fair enough. That's a great memory.
The final was pretty sloppy, once again, hey, look at the history box. That's it, doesn't matter. Chockies.
And look, we've been going a little while now, so I don't want to keep you all day. We'll end on this because this is a pretty good question. It's from David Marshall. He says, which colleague from your radio career would you most like to take a penalty against and why? And who would you like taking the penalty if you were goalkeeper and why? Now, you say you're a pretty good goalkeeper. So, what do you reckon?
Okay. I have to pick who. I mean, maybe I'd take the penalty against Ben just because easy. Like, I'd slot that easy. And who would I want to take the penalty? Jeez, out of all the people I've worked with, it's a tricky one. I'm trying to work out if I want it to be like a good, someone good at penalties or not. I don't know. I know Matt O'Kine used to play for the ABC team.
Okay.
Like Tom Tilley, who used to host Hack, he's a bit of an athlete. Yeah, I'd like to take him down a peg. I'd like Tom Tilley to take it. He's, he's pretty good at sports, and I'd like to really prove myself. Yeah, it's him. Yeah, geez, that'd be good. Just one story. I don't know if you've seen this. Just before we finished, I just thought I'd share because it's a good football story. But I'm going to be up.
Take away.
I watched the Copa America on that Sunday morning on my Optus Fetch Box. And I got my Optus Fetch Box for free with unlocked movies, TV shows, and unlimited Optus Sport. And I got that because an Australian football legend degraded me on television. Do you know about this?
No. My memory, please.
This is good one. So do you remember earlier in the podcast I told you one of my heroes, a certain goalkeeper who made 2 big saves in the Uruguay game before Johnny Aloisi slumped the goal to send Australia through to their second ever World Cup.
Yeah, the greatest goalkeeper in Australian history.
We're speaking of Mark Schwarzer. Well, the year was 2018 when this great podcast started, I believe. Yes. The World Cup was about to start, and one Mark Schwarzer, who I trained with at Fulham back in 2010, was in the Triple J studio. It's very exciting. And we had Mark on, had a great chat. And what happened is I showed him some photos of the first time I met, which was at the book signing of Megs Morrison, his book, back in 2008. Then there was a photo of us training at Fulham. And then, of course, after one of the Fulham games at Craven Cottage, which I went to see a few years later. And anyway, so Ben said that, Ben sort of said, my co-host said, you know, Williams, you're his hero. He actually wanted to be a goalkeeper, and he said, like, oh, aren't you a bit short to be a goalkeeper? Wouldn't have thought so. Ouch. Punch in the guts from Mark. And standing at a whopping 181 centimetres, you know, some would say slightly above average. It's not goalkeeper size, but, no. You know, you can get away with it. I can touch the crossbar, guys.
Yeah, probably more a right back sort of area, you know what I mean?
That's it. And look, I know this, but, you know, you got to remember when I quit, you know, I could have got taller at that point. So I didn't know. I had a bone scan actually for the state team. It's supposed to be 191. So I don't know where those 10 centimeters went, possibly around my guts. Anyway, so this is true. So I'm watching. So like a couple of days later, I think it was before the France-Australia game, like the first game for, you know, it's the tournament. And just before the game, like Schwartz, he was like a pundit at the time. And they said, oh, Schwartz, like, what happened this week? Like, you broke this young fan's heart. And they played the footage of him calling me too short. And they're all laughing, going, oh, you know, Schwartz. And he goes, well, actually don't, you can, I want to actually send you this. Maybe you can put it on your Instagram. I'll send you.
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
He goes, the thing is, I don't really care because the thing is, he was a bit of a creep. He was a bit of a weird guy. Like he was showing me all these photos of him and me, and he was like a bit weird. And like, to be honest, we all know Mark Schwartz is just making a joke. Like it's, you know, he's having, but also what I will say, Mark Schwartzer, great goalkeeper. Wouldn't say he's the biggest stand-up comedian in the world. I don't think his comic timing has necessarily been finessed yet. And so this is 2018. This is my second year of Triple J. By this point, everyone's on board. And I was watching it going like, like Mark Schwartz is talking about me with my face like before the World Cup on the TV. I'm like, what is happening? And he called me a creep. And I also was like, this hurt like a little bit. But the main part of me was like, this is so fucking funny, right? Like, this is awesome. I've got this footage. I can bring this to the show and show Ben, like, this is my hero talking about me, like, crushing me. It was like a great thing, and I put it on Triple J. To be honest, I felt really bad because, you know how I said the Triple J audience is passionate, but once you've got them on side, they'll like love you forever. And people were drilling Mark. We put it up on our Instagram, and people were just drilling Mark Schwarzer, and he was kind of new to Instagram at the time, and he had like 6,000 followers, and there was this one post that he like just uploaded like a selfie, and there was like hundreds of comments of people being like, how dare you, like, he was a fan, like, you know, and like, and then I was actually like jumping in the comments being like, hey guys, like, this is a joke, like, and I was like trying to defend Mark Schwarzer, like, but then Optus reached out to me and they like had like an formal like apology, and they like sent me like an official full like Socceroos kit and gave me this fetch box, which I still use to this day. And it's like you click on the movies and it says like $6.99 to buy. And like I don't have to buy it, like it's linked there.
Right.
So they gave me like this free pass. Yeah, literally. So that's my Schwarzer story.
Wow, that's brilliant. Yeah. I think go on.
Yeah. He called me a creep on the TV and now I get free Optus Sport because of it. So there you go.
that's really funny. That's crazy. I think that wasn't a good tournament for them as well, so they've obviously got the PR disaster that is,
well,
Mark Schwarzer were calling you a creep. But then on top of that, you remember the stream didn't work as well.
Yeah, and then SBS were like, yeah, we'll just do it for free, like we've always done, no worries. And their app was like just ready like within that week. Good on you, SBS, absolute legends. Also I just wanted to say as well, when I got those photos of Mark Schwarzer, I was like under the age of 18 and all those photos. I was like 12 at his first book signing, okay? And I think it was that creepy, guys. Okay, I loved him. He was my hero. And I had some photos with him, whatever.
Yeah.
Gosh.
Maybe we'll have to try and get him on the podcast to just have his rebuttal. Yeah. You know? Maybe we'll see what happens.
I feel like it's a bit awkward now. I'd love to have him back on one day to talk about it.
Bloody hell. Hopefully you do. That would be funny. All right, mate. Look, it's been over an hour now. It's been excellent to talk to you, Lambs. That was a lot of fun. I am concerned. We did have some technical difficulties, so I'm getting concerned that it's going to shit itself again and we might lose this. So in the event of that not happening, I'm happy to call it there. And thanks for coming on the Shooting Tsars podcast, and I look forward to hearing that song that I played earlier on your radio show.
Yeah,
on Monday.
Bloody oath. Stewie, thank you, mate, appreciate it. Hopefully the three lines roar and they don't whimper on Monday morning, and they get the big win. It'd be nice to say, but I'll have to jump on again sometime. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, too easy. And for everybody, Bryce and Alex will be getting back together again to have a chat. So until then, thanks for listening.